same yesterday, today, and forever, as we read in Scripture, so time doesn't matter to God. So God was favorable.
Before I start, I miss the old podium record. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. Brothers and sisters, put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, heartfelt compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another, and forgiving one another. If one has a grievance against another, as the Lord has forgiven you, you must also do this. And over all things, put on love. That is the bond of perfection. And let the peace of Christ control your hearts, the peace into which you were also called into one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, as in all wisdom you teach, admonish one another, singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, in word or in deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Proclaim liberty to captives and He said to them, "Today, this scripture passage is fulfilled in your hearing." The Gospel of the Lord.
Needed to assure his Gentile Christians that
that one does not have to be Jewish to follow Christ. If a Samaritan, of all people, could exhibit Christ-like love, so too could a Greek, so too could an Irishman by Jim, and so could we. In the Gospel of Luke, Jesus displays a prodigious outpouring of energy in preaching and in ministry. And yet, he always finds times and places to pray. Jim, too, always found times and places to pray. And he was faithful to the prayer times of the fraternities in which he lived. It was how he kept his eyes on the prize. It was how he kept his eyes firmly fixed upon Jesus. And he alternated these times of prayer with exquisite acts of kindness, as did Jesus in the Gospel of Luke, and as did his favorite mentor, Francis of Assisi, as well. Among all of the evangelists, only Luke, for sure, never met Jesus in person. All he knew of Jesus, he learned from the apostles, especially Paul. And for that, he was eternally grateful. Jim, too, was grateful for those who witnessed faith to him, especially his parents, Nellie and James. Jim's remark to me one day about his parents and mine was that we really do stand on the shoulders of giants. That was my second memorable bit of conversation with him. He was so grateful for what such extraordinary, ordinary people had accomplished with their deep faith, their courage, hard work, perseverance, and their unwavering dedication to Sacred Heart Parish and Sacred Heart School. He marveled that because of them, a kid like him from Lewis Avenue could one day wind up being rector of a seminary, a vice provincial on the island of Guam, on the other side of the world. Like Luke, Jim knew what he had, and he knew from whom he got it. Each of the four evangelists identifies one fatal flaw that precludes all possibility of living a full human life. For Mark, it is an unrepentant heart. For Matthew, hypocrisy. For John, darkness. For Luke, the impenetrable obstacle to full life is wealth. Whether it leads to the arrogance and greed of the privileged few, or to the grinding worry of many people who lack even basic necessities. Either way, preoccupation with wealth prevents a person from leading a full life. Francis of Assisi came to see the same thing with blinding clarity. So too did Jim. Standing one day on the coast of Maine, looking out over the vast Atlantic Ocean, he said half to himself and half to me, "We own nothing, but we have it all." That was my third bit of treasured conversation with him. Indeed, Jim had it all. Precisely because he didn't worry about, defend, or protect any little bit of it that he supposedly owned. as if such ownership would give him happiness or fulfillment. It is Luke who recorded for us Jesus' teaching about the foolish man who owned so much stuff that he had to keep worrying about building bigger barns to keep it all in, and it was all stuff that he would never get to use or enjoy. And about the rich man and Lazarus, who met diametrically opposite fates. And about the rich young man, who could not or would not trade what he owned to gain limitless treasures in heaven. Jim owned nothing, but he had and enjoyed all of it. Music, culture, nature, beauty, silence, family, friendship, fraternity, the birds of the air, the lilies of the field, all his to enjoy without possessing any other. His life of poverty was rich and fulfilled. Rich with the word of Christ, filled with gratitude to God. Now we stand on his shoulders, and for that we should be most grateful. Jim, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he show his face to you and have mercy on you. May he turn his countenance to you and give you peace.
In baptism, Jim was given the pledge of eternal life. May he now be admitted to the company of the saints. We pray to the Lord. Our brother Jim spent his life following Jesus, poor, chaste, and obedient. Count him among the holy men and women who sing in your courts. We pray to the Lord. Our brother Jim shared the priesthood of Jesus Christ, leading God's people in prayer, celebrating the sacraments, and encouraging them with his preaching. Bring him into your presence, where he will take his place in the heavenly liturgy. We pray to the Lord. Many friends and members of our families, including James Gavin and Nell Gavin, have gone before us and await the fullness of the kingdom. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. Pray to the
Lord.
Many people die by violence, war, pandemic, and famine each day. Show your mercy to those who suffer so unjustly, and gather them into your kingdom of peace. We pray to the Lord. Jim's family and friends seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. We pray to the Lord. We have come in faith and confidence to pray for our brother Jim. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the exception of your Son's coming. We pray to the Lord.
And with all of
Scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant James, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow all that is good.
sacrament of salvation. We implore your kindness, O God, for Jim, your servant and priest, that as you have made him a steward of your mysteries on earth, so you may bring him to be nourished by your truth and reality as unveiled in heaven. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I am Tom Gavin, brother. Brother of Jim. The Gavin family is so grateful for all the Capuchin ancestor family. We thank the Capuchins for giving Jim constant care, especially for you. Struggle with pulmonary fibrosis and the effects of medication. Thank you, Father Michael Conner. Thank you, Father Saint Taylor, and all the staff at St. Louis for your dedication to Jim. We also thank Father Michael Greco, Father Bob Amadillo, and for Father John McHugh for arranging today's memorial mass. The Gavin family is so happy to see all of you coming together to honor, reflect, and celebrate the life of our brother, Father James Jimmy. We truly feel Jimmy's presence at this memorial mass. I have a special honor of presenting this eulogy, and I will share a few personal stories which family members remember about Jimmy. Brother Billy, Jimmy's brother, track star at Sacred Heart High School, remembers numerous morning phone calls on Jimmy during his struggle with pulmonary fibrosis. At 1 a.m., Billy's phone rings. Billy, this is an emergency. I have no job. On another occasion, at 2 a.m., Billy, this is an emergency. I have no chapsticks. Several days before Jimmy passed on April 11th, 2020, Jimmy called Billy at 3 a.m., asking, Billy, do you know why I became a Capuchin Franciscan priest? And before Billy could answer, Jimmy declared, to see the face of Jesus Christ. Billy was stunned, speechless, and amazed. Jimmy saw the face of Jesus Christ in all of us. We know Jimmy reflected the face of Jesus Christ to everyone in his whole life. Eileen, Jimmy's sister, remembers completing her shift at Woolworths at 6 p.m. Christmas Eve, 1954. As she approached the bus stop on Getty Square, She gazed at her brother, Jimmy, age 15, attempting to carry an unwieldy amount of new toys onto the number 2 bus. And I saw it today, it's still the number 2 bus. She rushed to assist Jimmy. They stepped off the number 2 bus at the corner of Park Avenue and shone in place. On this cold, dark night, they walked to our home on 34 Lewis Avenue, which is really 100 steps to this church. They then wrapped these toys and later placed them under the tree. Between wrapping and placing them under the tree, however, Jimmy joined his 3-year-old brother Fred in saying his nighttime prayers. As Jimmy took Francis to bed, Jimmy reassured Francis with these promising words, and Francis has never forgotten. When you wake up in the morning, Francis, you will receive what you ask for. Francis went to sleep, firmly believing in Jimmy's promise. Jimmy reflected the face of Jesus Christ to Eileen, to Francis, and to all of us on that Christmas Eve in 1954. Please understand, earlier that day, Jimmy saw his mom, was focused on caring for 8 of us. She barely had time to purchase toys. Our dad, Jim, who always sat in that left-hand corner by that confessional, worked long hours at the store on New Main Street all that day and evening. Jimmy responded selflessly by helping my parents to make certain that each of us would open a present on Christmas morning. Our sister Kathy tells us, Jimmy always listened to me, especially after my treasured cup of Starbucks coffee. Kathy remembers fondly how Jimmy set up a picnic for us with our blankets and a large umbrella in our backyard in summertime. Jimmy officiated at the marriage of Kathy and Steve, Russell and Danielle. Kathy cherished her special sister-brother relationship with Jimmy. Teresa, Sacred Heart class of 1968, dearly loved the occasions when Jimmy took her to Glen Park, where he worked during the summer. Over many years, she recalls how Jimmy provided her with enormous love and care. Jack, Sacred Heart's cross-country basketball and baseball legend, appreciated Jimmy's presence and participation at family gatherings in East Newark, New York. Jack and Martin revered Jimmy's presence at their family's baptisms, first Holy Communions, and weddings. I value Jimmy's presence at our children and grandchildren's baptisms and first Holy Communions. Mary and I are grateful that Jimmy officiated the wedding of Colleen and Dan and Chad, Sean and Ray in Philadelphia. Teresa Moran, Mary's mother, passed away in August 2011. The pastor of St. Clair's Church in Albany, New York, be unavailable because of renovation. We didn't know what to do, but we thought we asked Jamie for help. Yes, I will be honored, said Jamie. Mary and her siblings were so relieved. Jamie drove north from New York City to Albany, New York. And we remember to this day one of the best homilies we've ever heard. Jamie reflected the face of Jesus Christ with his passion. We thank Jimmy for all his caring, his comfort, and love, and for providing us with an enduring example of taking actions that reflect the face of Jesus Christ. If Jimmy were here now, he could ask, what actions will you take to reflect the face of Jesus Christ? We know Jimmy cared for all of you here today and those who could not attend. My sister Kathy is up. He saw the face of Jesus Christ in all of you. On behalf of the Gavin family and our brother Jimmy, we thank you for your presence.
Good afternoon. My name is Father Michael Brecker. I'm the provincial minister for the Friars. And Tom, I want to thank you for your beautiful words, beautiful descriptions of your beautiful stories that you shared with us. And it was an honor, as it always is, for us, for we Capuchins, to pray with the beloved family members of our brothers and to pray for our brothers in this time as they transition to the Lord. Your words were so beautiful, Father John's words, also so beautiful, magnificent. I'll only add one thing. We all have our impressions of Jim, one of our stories we will always tell them, and that's so important. And our impressions of Jim, most especially, and so one of his many gifts was his gift of hospitality, Jim. I think it's because he came from a family in the hospitality business, right? And then spent so many years among the island, kind of having taken in the island hospitality of Guam. So many years. He was beloved there. I've had the opportunity to go there a number of times now as provincial. So many, all these words of Jim Gavin's name. So, Father Jack Wexman and I were speaking about Jim, and Jack reminded me that Father Jim was superior of the island, captures on the island and vice provincial, if anybody was coming to visit, no matter what, if the flights came in at like 3 o'clock in the morning, as we've already seen, that doesn't really matter to Jim. He'd be up and he'd be at the airport to greet whoever came. And when it was time to leave, he'd be there to drop him off. So it's a beautiful way of showing fraternity to the Friars and care for guests, a true act of hospitality. And it makes me think something I'd like us to all kind of walk away with. How blessed we are to know that one day when we, like Jim, see the face of Jesus in the way that Jim is seeing the face of Jesus, and we reach our time and stand outside the pearly gates, as we call them, who will be there waiting for us in blessed and divine hospitality? But our beautiful beloved Jim Gavin, I think we have that gift to hold on to. But sisters, as we conclude our Mass, as Father John concludes our Mass, we will have a procession out to where Jim has been laid to rest in our Capuchin Cemetery, and continue our prayers.